So it was, you know, the scriptures would say, our beloved wine reappeared to prolong Samaria. Not only do we have the feeding of the 5,000, but also this wonderful story about Jesus walking on the water. So as I was thinking about what themes we could draw, it occurred to me that there's a question I'm always asked. And that is, what is the difference between a disciple and an apostle? Now, you've all heard of the 12 disciples. And sometimes we call them the 12 apostles. And then there's St. Paul the apostle. Now, is he a disciple? Good question. So in these stories we have today, as I was reading through, I find in them an example of this distinction of what it means to be a disciple, and then what it means to be an apostle. So let's begin with this word disciple. Now disciple comes from the Latin word discipulus, which means one who learns, a student. Now, some of you might know the Gospels were not written in Latin, but Greek. In fact, they weren't translated to Latin until the 5th century. That was the work of St. Jerome. Now, so the Gospels were in Greek. And the word for disciples in Greek is mathetai. It's where we get our word from mathematics. So clearly they all knew calculus. in fact, they were fishermen. They didn't know Greek. They didn't know math. All simple men. And they spoke Aramaic. Now, in Aramaic, the word for student and the word for disciples are talmidim. It's where we get the word talmud, which means learning. So again, these are learners. They're students, they know. I wouldn't go so far as to say they're illuminati, but they certainly they have the knowledge. Now, why do we use the word disciple then? Should we call them know-it-alls or knowers? No, we use the word disciple, and some scholars would argue that discipulus in Latin is from a compound verb, discipere, which means to take apart or absorb, or to go further, metabolize, or maybe even devour, consume. Now let's go back to our story. What's happening? We have a feeding of the 5,000. We have Jesus giving people something to chew on. And what we do most Sundays, we take the Eucharist. We chew on what Jesus gives us. Now, the Protestant reformers had some issue with this early on. But the point that we receive from Jesus, and that as disciples we accept the teaching, is still very much true. So to be a disciple is to take apart or seize upon what's offered to us, which is pretty great. I mean, Jesus does all the work, which again sounds pretty nice. But there is a danger. In fact, there's a danger on three levels: the individual, the church, and the state. And I'll go through these three dangers now. And I believe they're all represented in the story. So the people are fed, and they're happy. I mean, this is great, free food. Who doesn't like that? I mean, everyone likes the free stuff. So they say, oh, let's make Jesus king. And now, this is not really a symbolic gesture, as if to say, you know, yes, Jesus, we want him to be the Lord of our lives. No, they want to make him an actual king, with all that entails. And if you rewind the clock a bit and go to the book of Samuel, we find the story of the king Saul. We go to the king of Israel. Now, the prophet Samuel, I've been told by God, this is a bad idea. The king will rule harshly. A king will make demands. He'll send your kids to war. He'll tax you. It'll be bad. But the people choose Saul. And of course, like in any good Disney movie, there's a thunderstorm, it's very dramatic. You know, something evil is going down. Again, look at the story of Uriah. Today, also from the book of Samuel, the king David. Now, in one story, he breaks three of the Ten Commandments. And that's pretty good, that's enough for him, I guess. I mean, he covets his neighbor's wife. He has adultery with his neighbor's wife. And then he has his neighbor put to death. You know, well done, King David. So that's, you know, the greatest king of Israel. And if you follow his whole life, he actually breaks every one of the Ten Commandments. And in a big way, he's that kind of guy. Now, Jesus is not about that. And that's the Pontius Pilate. My kingdom is not of this world. Now, to get back to the dangers for us, on the individual level, there's a danger of passivity. And the danger of Jesus and me and the hell of me. The idea that, well, I'm going to remind you for my faith. And so it doesn't matter how I act. It doesn't matter how I treat people. It doesn't matter how I use my resources. And that's a major problem we see in the world. People's faith is so personal that they don't care for the community. I've got my salvation. I'm good to go. As for you, you're happy. You know, I know where you're going, and it's pretty hot down there. You know, and you can develop that kind of attitude. By only looking at yourself and not at others. Now, on the church level, in order for there to be an in crowd, us disciples, there must be an out crowd, not only for heathens. And to rebuild these walls, where we say, you know, we're good to go, we're disciples. We're Christians, with everyone else, forget it. They're lost, they're hopeless. You know, we don't really want to deal with them anyway. So that's the second danger. Now, the third danger is a very old danger. And we find it manifest in the medieval church. And a lot of times where all you need to do is to convert the king of a country. And he'll force everyone to be Christian. So you can have a Christian nation, a Christian country. And then you're good to go. Just to enforce it. Dominate, subjugate, take over. evangelize with the sword. Again, not the way of Jesus, not the gospel. And yet, if you look at the news today, a group like ISIS, for example, want to dominate while they create a and Islamic state. I'm granted they're not Christian. But that principle of domination by the sword is very real today and very dangerous. Again, it's not the way of God and not the way of Christ. And it's all about spreading the brand and not about an inner conviction. And so there's a danger there in being a disciple by name, but not in action. Now, apostle is an old word meaning to be sent out. It's the action side. But action without conviction, without faith, can be equally dead. So now, let's turn to our first story. So, Jesus runs away. They want to make him king. He's not about that. He's out of there. It's getting late. People are fed. And it's time for the disciples to leave. They get the boat, and they head across the Sea of Galilee. It's dark. And now a storm comes out of nowhere. They're being tossed here and there. So in confusion, they have no idea if they're getting any closer. And it's seeming pretty hopeless. Now, what happens to us when we leave church or when we leave our time of prayer? Where is Jesus when life gets rough? It's great to go to church and feel God's presence. But where is God? Where is Jesus when we meet his presence? Where is he Tuesday morning? Say you're at work, and then that work is dead. What are you going to do? You're in a jam. Or you're at the supermarket. You're in the express checkout lane. But the woman in front of you did not get the memo about 12 items or less. How are you going to respond to that? Or your kids are acting up. And they're really pushing your buttons. Where is Jesus now? Where is God now? The doctor gives you bad news. Where is God now? You know, what are you going to do? Are you going to lose it when the boat gets rocky? Well, what happens in the story? They're struggling, toiling in the dark. They have no sense of purpose. And then they see this mysterious figure walking on the water. And they don't know it's Jesus right away. And so naturally, they freak out. The unexpected has happened. And they are terrified. And you might be. And as we are when the unexpected happens to us. But then Jesus says in his eye, "Do not be afraid." And in this, I hear echoes of what God said to Moses. I am that I am. God in control. God of comfort. And if you think about it, that's what God can bring to us. In the struggle. In the unexpected. And an interesting point for town where the disciples, apostles are headed. Capernaum. or Capernaum. That's actually a Greek translation of the Hebrew Kfar Naum, which means the town of comfort. Almost a promised land of sorts. Now, in reality, it's just a made-up town. But I believe that John wrote this gospel. Might be wrong to tell us a bit more. The scripture says that when Jesus is welcomed into the boat, immediately they arrive at the destination. Immediately they are comforted. And that the storm dies down. Now, you could say, well, why did God send the storm in the first place? Why make their lives so difficult? Why is it difficult in our own lives? And yet that is the great mystery of being alive, of being apostles, of being on a journey. God has sent us, placed us, given us our talents, our vocations, and we all have gifts, we all have something to offer. And God encourages us to be our best selves. As Jesus is the image of God's love and represents the maximization of human potential, that's what God can bring out in us. We can't control the storm of life. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I can't tell you what's going to happen this afternoon. But what I do know, all I can share, is that God has the power to bring out our best and to give us what we need for every circumstance. And that grace of God, that logic of grace, because sometimes our own logic will fail, but God's love is radical love. That's something you can take to the supermarket. You can take it to work. When the IT guy comes to help you, is he your personal butler, or will you treat him with respect? Will you be nice in the supermarket? So that lady is not reading the memo. That's a choice we all have to make. You can take it to the supermarket, you can take it to a bank. But you don't need to take it to the bank, and here's why. Because the check is cashed. The debt is already paid. God in Christ has done for us what we cannot do for ourselves. And because of that, all we have to do is welcome him into our boat, into our talents, our professions, and our lives. And then we'll find ourselves at our destination. Let us pray. God in heaven, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for our passions, our vocations, our talents, and all the opportunities we have to serve you. Be with us, we pray. On the road, on the journey of life. Give us strength for every task. And be glorified in all that we do. All this we pray in and through Jesus Christ. Amen.